Thanks very much for turning out for this latest installment of News from Underground. We thought that, you know, since we're right here in town, we would take this opportunity to focus on something that's been on my mind lately, and that is the 2031 expansion plan at NYU. We want to focus specifically on the corporate university and its relations with the city, and I guess in this case with big real estate. It is unfortunate that Jennifer Washburn can't be with us tonight. She wrote this marvelous book, University Incorporated, but she has a family crisis. She's on the West Coast. She sends her apologies. It kind of throws off the balance here, but I think we'll prevail anyway. I'm going to introduce our panelists, and then I'm going to introduce the panel with some remarks of my own. First is my friend and colleague, Andrew Ross, who teaches at NYU. So, you know, he gets sort of top billing. He is in the Department of Social and Political Analysis, and his latest book is Bird on Fire. It's about Phoenix and the ecology of cities and so on. He's written many other books. And we're very lucky to have our other two panelists with us to make this a kind of New York-wide critique of what's happening just downtown. Sharon Zukin is a professor of sociology at Brooklyn College and the CUNY Grad Center, mm-hmm. and the author of most recently, Naked City, The Death and Life of Authentic Urban Places. And she'll be followed by Tom Angotti, who has written, among other books, New York for Sale. That's his latest book. And he has a long handle I have to read. He's director of the Hunter College Center for Community Planning and Development and professor of urban affairs and planning at Hunter College. I'm going to say this now, and I'll say it again at the end. This is an independent bookstore. These are the authors of books published by university presses. You're going to get more than your money's worth tonight, so it would be really wonderful of you to buy their books, okay? And they will be glad to sign them. Okay, let me talk a little bit about what's been happening. As some of you may know, Andrew and I and a lot of our other colleagues are part of something called NYU Faculty Against the Sexton Plan, which is what we call the NYU 2031 plan, because we don't think it really represents NYU insofar as a university is its faculty at any rate, as opposed to its board of trustees. It's not really an NYU thing. It's really coming only out of the president's office at NYU, so we thought we would name it after him, called the Sexton Plan. And we knew all along, and this is an important point, that our opposition to this thing would make a tremendous difference. Because the first time in the history of the village and the history of NYU's development of the village, that it isn't just the community opposing the university. If you go back, you look at the way their previous complaints and activism and so on have been covered, it's always been dismissive, derisive, laughing at them for their quaintness and their backwardness and their bohemianism and so on. And it's therefore been very easy to dismiss them. And this is like since the late 50s, okay? So as I say, we knew that this would make it a better story. And indeed, you know, I have to say, we have gotten pretty decent coverage, right? But I want to say something about the coverage. It's very interesting. We got great coverage twice so far on Fox 5. I don't know. You tell me. New York, what is it called? CapitalNewYork.com. It's a financial news website. Great, great coverage, you know? And even a mention in the New York Times by Joe Berger, who referred to some faculty opposing the plan. There's actually hundreds of us, two-thirds of whom are anonymous because they're terrified, which is sort of revealing. But he did mention some faculty, so we have gotten this coverage. However, we've noticed that the most prominent coverage has stuck very, very closely to that old narrative. Okay? In other words, the story of the village crazies versus the unified university is very hard to kill, you see? So, for example, the New York Daily News, owned by developer and NYU trustee Mort Zuckerman, has run two pieces in favor of the Sexton plan, including an amusing op-ed by Ed Koch, who actually says in the second paragraph that his law firm happens to have been hired by NYU to promote the plan, but that has nothing to do with his writing the piece. You know, and we asked ourselves, they can't do better than this, you know? So that was interesting. But again, in that paper, the line is, these people, they're impeding progress, these crazy people. Same with the New York Post. And same with a much better piece that came out on Sunday, a huge, prominent piece by Michael Kimmelman, who, although he knew very well that we were here, because we talked to him, still did not or could not depart from the narrative. And if you read it, how many of you read that piece? I mean, you could not know from that piece there was faculty resistance, right? Well, that's related to the fact that President Sexton himself has refused to mention us or acknowledge us. In fact, at one point at a recent meeting with students, actually said there was only resistance in the community. And it was like one or two people with political ambitions and, I guess, mental problems and, But he said, I want to make clear that I'm not talking about the faculty, see? So, this is my segue. We are here as, academics, all of us up here. And we are, I feel safe in saying we're standing very close to the community. I mean, there's no daylight between us at all. We have our own particular reasons for opposing this plan in addition to the community's reasons, because we do believe that this plan could actually bring down the university financially and academically. And that's an argument that has grabbed almost the whole faculty as far as we know, including the most conservative, you see. At any rate, we're here, we're in a public forum, we're going to talk about the corporate university, real estate, the city. This is a subject that's really, it has vast ramifications, and we're going to try to explore as many of them as we can. So, having said that, let me turn to Andrew, and what we'll do is we'll each talk for 10 or so minutes, and then we'll throw it open to questions.
Thank you, Mark, and good evening, people. Thanks for coming along. Before I get to NYU, I want to say a few words about urban renewal, because there's a larger context for the topic of discussion tonight, and it has to do with urban renewal. We speak about urban renewal often as if it was in the past, and certainly its heyday was in the 1950s and 1960s, but it never really went away. We've just given it different names in the decades since then. And certainly after the several decades after that heyday, we were still seeing super block building, the paradigm of doing mega projects and displacing populations that was characteristic of urban renewal. Mega projects in the form of sports stadia and convention centers and museums and so on and so forth. I beg your pardon. This was a paradigm that really lasted until the 1990s. It didn't really fade until the 1990s, when planners began to take on fine-grained planning and mixed-use zoning as their dominant paradigm. And of course, all these mega projects had huge public subsidies and very limited public economic impact. In fact, famously, a Chicago economist once estimated if you took all the money that went into a public subsidy for a typical downtown sports stadium and just threw the money out of a helicopter over the downtown area, it would have more public economic impact, much more than the sports stadium itself. Now, since the 1990s, there have been two paradigms that have emerged as a turnaround strategy for cities that are struggling with their downtown areas. One is, and both of them are tied to the high-wage knowledge economy. One was the creative city, which was sort of popularized by Richard Florida, and it revolved around recruiting creative talent to downtown areas. It was a much cheaper urban policy than one that was aimed at recruiting corporate investors with lavish tax breaks. You know, the creatives don't need that much. You know, a few biking trails, some, you know, fair trade coffee houses, and the semblance of an art gallery scene to attract, you know, the all-important gay population. Because we know that all gay people are born with a creative gene, right? So there was that paradigm, and then the other paradigm was called meds and eds. And meds and eds is where the topic for this evening comes in, fits very neatly into there, because at a certain point, City Hall, urban economic managers began to figure out that urban universities can and should be playing a very important role in the urban growth machine, that they could be economic drivers in and of themselves in their own right. Up until that point, City Hall had pretty much taken for granted these urban universities, but then they began to figure out, well, they generate a lot of economic inputs, a lot of research monies. They train all these creatives, these young creatives who are likely to hang around and live in downtown areas. And unlike corporations and major league franchises, they're not going to leave town very quickly. They're not fly-by-night entities. So the idea was that they could be more and more integrated into the urban growth machine. And chambers of commerce in various cities began to look to urban universities specifically to generate wealth and population and prestige and so on and so forth. Some cities, like Pittsburgh, for example, claim that their meds and eds policy was really responsible for their economic turnaround. Other cities began to lure urban universities into their downtown areas. Phoenix, which my most recent book was about Phoenix, is one of those cities. Phoenix very faithfully followed the recipe for each of these paradigms in the decades since urban renewal, and they persuaded ASU, Arizona State University, to build a brand new campus downtown. And they also generated a pile of taxpayer subsidy for a big biomedical complex to go right next to it. Mesa, which is one of Phoenix's satellite cities, and a city that's bigger than Atlanta or Miami, is out there now advertising for universities to come and relocate in their downtown. So this is a real strategy. In cities like, in a metropolis like New York City, where do the existing urban universities fit into a recalibrated growth machine that isn't simply dependent on the FIRE sector, which is the finance, insurance, and real estate, the core sector of New York City economy? Well, NYU is a case in point. John Sexton, our current president, shortly after he came into office, started talking a lot about something called the ICE sector, ICE, which stands for intellectual, cultural, and educational industries. And so the idea was that, you know, fire and ice, right? Get it?
It's a great poem.
It hasn't caught on as a slogan, but give it time. And so a lot of statistics were generated to show that the ICE sector might actually be more resilient in the long run than the FIRE sector, and certainly would be less susceptible to the impact of financial crashes and the like. Not that these are distinct sectors, if you really look at it very closely. The FIRE sector is very heavily interlocked into the ICE sector, especially in the case of somewhere like NYU, which has a massive real estate presence on the one hand and is also heavily dependent, massively dependent on student loans and student debt in order to fund its operating budget. And student loans are the most profitable loans you can make in the finance industry. So there's really a very high tie-in there on the part of and in the interlocking of fire and ice. And if you look closely at the NYU's Board of Trustees, you see even more of an overlap. NYU's Board of Trustees is full of some of the biggest land developers in the city, some of the wealthiest financiers, and a bevy of corporate tycoons who include the likes of Catherine Reynolds, who, among other properties, owns EduCap, which makes high-interest predatory loans to unsuspecting students. And this brings us to the NYU expansion plan, because these people are members of what you could call New York City's permanent government, right? And no aspiring politician is going to want to alienate a crowd with this kind of clout, let alone aspirants to the mayor's office. NYU's expansion plan, as you know, and as Mark has reinforced this evening, has generated a lot of ill will and opposition from faculty, from students, from residents, and from all manner of wildlife in downtown Manhattan. I guess the question I want to ask this evening is, to what degree is this part of the growth machine? How can we talk about this expansion plan as part of the growth machine? A lot of the critics of the growth machine over the years have challenged the truism that growth pays for itself. It does not pay for itself. However, it is a very efficient way of transferring public monies to private pockets. That's one thing the growth machine is very, very good at. And that was the case during the managerial phase of urban capitalism, when governments socialized the costs of capitalist land development. But it's even been more visibly so in the neoliberal or entrepreneurial phase of urban capitalism in the last 30 years or so. How do we talk about NYU as a case study in transferring public monies to private pockets? It's not easy to do this, but I'm going to make an effort very briefly. Although it's a private university, NYU depends upon a lot of public monies. Massive array of federal grants from multiple government agencies flow into NYU to fund its research apparatus. New York State provides a lot of subsidies to NYU, at least $50 million a year. The New York State Dormitory Authority funds all of the residential dorms that NYU has built in its transition from being a commuter college to a residential national university. And last but not least, a massive amount of federal student loans upon which NYU fully depends, as I said earlier, for its operating budget. In 2010, I think the accumulated student debt at NYU was about $660 million, which is, you know, larger than the GDP of many countries in the world. And NYU currently ranks number one in the country among nonprofit universities for the average student debt per capita. It's 40% above the national average. So that's a vast amount of public money. And it's pretty clear, from our perspective, I think it's pretty clear that the major financing for NYU's $6 billion expansion plan will come from increases in student debt over the next decade or so. I mean, it couldn't go higher in the national rankings, but the actual volume of debt can go much higher and probably will go much higher. So we're talking about all of these public monies to a private university at a time when public universities are being put to the sword, which is just patently unfair. How do these public monies transfer into lining private pockets. As I said, it's more difficult to prove all of this. But certainly, if you could start with payroll, with employee payroll, there's no question that we've seen the upward redistribution of wealth, just in terms of employee salaries, to senior administrators. And senior administrators' salaries have skyrocketed over the last 15 years or so, with the spread from the very top to the very bottom at NYU approximating the worst kind of corporate-style ratios of CEO to the most lowly employee. The other employee salary category that has been a clear beneficiary are key faculty who bring in top-line grant money, multi-year grant money, and also key faculty who generate intellectual property on behalf of the university. And this is very important because NYU is either number one or number two nationally, again, in generating revenue from licensing its intellectual property. And this is another instance of public monies being transferred into a private excludable good, because most of the intellectual property is generated out of public research grants, and then it gets propertized into something that is a private excludable good. And Jennifer Washburn has written very well about this in her book. Too bad she's not here this evening. So certainly there's an analysis there of how the public monies get transferred into lining public pockets. But the most pervasive community rumor lies in NYU's ties to real estate. And this is the murky part of it. I don't know anyone who's done a really concrete or conclusive analysis of this, but I've met countless alumni who like to take some pleasure in describing NYU as a real estate company, which also issues degrees. And I've often thought about that kind of quip. What actually does it mean? Certainly, it's one of the two or three top landowners in the city, and as such, it has a very hefty real estate portfolio, and it seems to be very busy buying and selling properties on a regular basis and land banking buildings for future profits and so on and so forth. Very, very busy in that area. It also, an administrator once told me that he felt that he was running a hotel and restaurant chain. Given the number of dormitory beds and cafeteria seats that NYU caters to on a daily basis. And there's probably some truth to that too. So if you're operating at that level of volume, there's no way that you're not going to generate a tidy list of clients and contractors who are favored in some way. And there are a lot of favored clients and contractors on that list. So we could say, at the very least, that NYU is a nonprofit institution that generates a lot of private profits, right? That generates a lot of profits for private individuals and private entities, at the very least. Further than that, I don't know what I can say about the private profit structure, because NYU's books are closed. There's no fiscal transparency. And when we as faculty at the university are asked about this or that aspect of university policy that relates to fiscal matters, we're pretty much in the dark. We say, look, we have no clue. We don't have any access to the budget. We don't know anything about the finances. So this is this is guesswork. That said, there's probably nothing that long-term employees like Mark and myself would be surprised to learn if the books were actually opened and the private profit structure that clearly must be beneficiaries of this transfer from public, the public purse to private pockets were to be fully revealed. Let me just say, however, that it's probably not a great leap to imagine that, or to conclude that, if you're doing $6 billion worth of building downtown, that is a huge boost to the developer's growth machine, whether it's directly or indirectly. It does generate a lot of profits for builders and contractors. It will amp up rents in the neighborhood, and it will add nothing to the city's affordable housing stock, which is a topic of great concern to a lot of us. Let me just finish by saying that I'm really responding to the title of the session here, is NYU a corporation? And I have to say, I'm not a big fan of talking about corporate universities. I don't think universities are corporations. I don't think they approximate to corporations. And so I find it a little lazy when colleagues are gathered around the academic water cooler and talk about the corporate university. And I understand why that is the case. And it's very good for consciousness raising, but I don't find it very accurate as a form of analysis. And this may be academic to some of you, but I do believe that the corporate restructuring proceeds at a very dizzying rate, at a rate that makes even the most entrepreneurial university feel like a medieval monastery. There's no real comparison. And I also think that universities' orientation to the marketplace is not like corporations' orientation to the marketplace. It's not even like corporations, I think, that operate in the military sector, which is a place that depends very heavily on federal, public federal monies and guarantees and contracts and so on and so forth. I prefer to think of universities, or especially urban research universities like NYU, as an organizational species in their own right. They're rapidly evolving. And they're rapidly evolving along their own power track. But they're not like corporations. And that power track is one which involves forgetting or sloughing off a lot of customs and functions they used to have that related to public accountability, to inclusion and access, and so on and so forth. And I just want to end by invoking C. Wright Mills. Some of you may remember C. Wright Mills, his analysis of the power elites in the heyday of the Cold War. According to Mills, the power elites were composed of interlocking directorates that were drawn from government, corporations, and military. It was a tripartite structure. And I think we're no longer in a tripartite structure. It's much more polynuclear now. There are many more nuclei on that landscape, on the power landscape, and urban research universities are becoming a nucleus unto themselves on that landscape. They are, as I said, they're marshaling their own resources and wielding their own, throwing around their weight, as it were, not just in the cities that host them, but also in overseas locations where they're increasingly operating. And that's obviously the other part of NYU's growth plan, is being pushing into offshore locations at a rate far faster than any other university. And it's part and parcel of this growth rationale that we have to somehow grow. The rationale for this, incidentally, is that NYU has a low endowment, and therefore to catch up with the Ivy League institutions to which it aspires to be peer, it has to grow very rapidly, and grow it certainly has done. And the other, I'll just finish, the other rationale for the growth and for the plan in general is that NYU students have much less space per capita than Harvard students do. This is one of it's a very flimsy rationale, but it's the only rationale that's actually been offered for the expansion plan. Let me tell you, I've never met an NYU student who's clamoring for more space. It's just not a priority. It's not even a thought on their minds. No one comes to NYU for space. No one comes to New York City for space. This is a very urban question, right? How much space are you entitled to? I'll just leave you with that question dangling. Thank you.
Andrew said everything. But ever since I published Naked City, I feel that I'm invited to channel Jane Jacobs. So I'm going to try to do my best and to speak personally and with a lot of common sense, the way Jane Jacobs did. I've lived in Greenwich Village, very close to NYU. Okay, is this better? I've lived in Greenwich Village, very close to NYU, for more than 30 years. I cannot say that NYU has caused the gentrification of Greenwich Village because it was already a middle-class neighborhood when I moved in. But I have seen the last bits of history and diversity commodified, swallowed up by NYU's enormous and pretty ugly buildings, so that now the university not only uses Washington Square Park for certain occasions, but also has ringed three sides of Washington Square Park with its own facilities. Maybe the students at NYU are over indebted, but some of them have parents who invest in property in the area, buying apartments. That has raised rents and encouraged landlords to go co-op and condo faster than they might ordinarily have done. NYU students, a lively and pleasure-seeking bunch, I'm sure, fill the streets so that, and I can't entirely blame young people for this, but you know, their increase in numbers has caused my local shopping street, University Place, to turn into an elongated food court filled with restaurants that are geared toward the pocketbooks of middle class and upper middle class students and toward the tastes of college students rather than toward the more varied residential population of the village. And there is no more bakery, no more fish store, no more butcher shop, and so on. On University Place, it's true that Whole Foods has sucked the lifeblood out of the supermarkets on University Place, but rents have also played a role, so that no new business has opened on the five or six blocks of University Place in the last year that is not a restaurant, exaggerating the trend throughout major cities of the world and throughout New York City, and shaping that trend around the large and growing NYU student population. A student population whose need for diversion extends through the East Village and down through the Lower East Side. Again, I can't blame young people for causing the commercial gentrification of a large area of Lower Manhattan, but there is a much larger college population now that creates a market for a certain kind of nighttime economy, which was not the nighttime economy of Greenwich Village or the East Village or the Lower East Side more than 10 years ago. So, I look around and I see that I am living not in Greenwich Village, but in a factory town. Okay, maybe my analysis is loose here, but the big dog in this area is NYU. I should not be surprised that NYU is in 2012 such an arrogant actor and a bad neighbor, because I became an urban sociologist in part because of NYU's drive for profit. Back in the late 1970s, when I was peacefully living in my loft in Greenwich Village, I read one day in the New York Times that some of the last remaining manufacturers on Broadway were being evicted from their small factories by their landlord, NYU, so that NYU could turn these buildings around 4th Street and Broadway, turn these buildings over to a major national real estate development firm, Swigweiler and Arno, to convert these loft buildings from factories into loft apartments. And that's how I started to do research on living lofts, because I ran down the street to these manufacturers and offered my services, such as sociological services are. But we managed to make a pretty good case to the local community board, Community Board 2, which nonetheless, regardless of our efforts, is a very aware, very informed, and very activist community board, and they wrangled with NYU to get financial compensation for these manufacturers. They were not able to stave off the transformation of factories into loft apartments, but they did really well by the manufacturers. So I'm not surprised that 30 years later, NYU is now trying to spiritually evict residents of the village from the enjoyment of their space. But why should I have been surprised in the 1970s? Because back in the 1950s, NYU worked together with Robert Moses and used the urban renewal funds that were made available by the U.S. Congress at that time to clear the loft buildings, to demolish the loft buildings that they then developed as, excuse the expression, faculty housing for some of my friends and colleagues at NYU. Washington Square Village and Silver Towers were built with urban renewal funds in the 1950s and early 1960s. And that was just one example, kind of Lincoln Center in Greenwich Village, one example in our neighborhood of the university taking advantage of public funds to grow, to expand its footprint in Greenwich Village. So, what we see now in the 21st century is a perfect meeting of the entrepreneurial university and the entrepreneurial city. Yes, I think the fire and ice strategy that President Sexton announced a few years ago is exactly what New York wants, and other cities around the world are looking to do the same thing. In France, the French government, because there it's the national government rather than the local or metropolitan government that would be the prime public actor in these sorts of plans, the French government is trying to convince all of the Parisian university system, natural sciences, literary people, and social sciences, to move out of their assorted properties in Paris to Saclay, which is underused and unused industrial space to the east of the city. And there they are going to make a, they are intending to make a big post-metropolitan entrepreneurial university that will encourage new intellectual property to be created and glory and also money to flow into the French nation state. The Netherlands is trying to do the same thing by consolidating some universities and some parts of universities and to make a bigger presence, moving the different parts of Dutch universities around like pieces on a chessboard, but to make a weightier global competitor that will be able to draw more overseas students and create more profitable inventions, in contrast to Oxford and Cambridge. The ratings of universities that we know from U.S. News and World Report, which seems to be oriented toward college-bound U.S. students, in fact have become a huge global rivalry system where national governments are looking zealously at their ratings to try to beef up their universities, make them larger, give them a larger footprint wherever they're located, and compete for, again, the tuition payments of overseas students, to compete with, yes, intellectual stars who will bring in more grants and make more unread publications, as the economist Bob Frank said in the business section of the Times the other week, and will give greater glory to the nation state, the force behind Oxford, Cambridge, University of Amsterdam, and in our case, the city government, which is the force behind, the public force behind NYU and Columbia. Because our city is really being divided into these feudal university turfs, with Columbia uptown and NYU downtown, and, if the website is to be believed, in Brooklyn and on Governor's Island. And of course, Cornell, the Outlander, is coming into Roosevelt Island. So, you know, the city, the growth turfs of the city are being divvied up among the universities. Now, I don't know whether there's a direct connection, Andrew actually said, I think correctly, indirect relation with real estate developers in New York City. But it cannot hurt the interests of place elites and place entrepreneurs that universities, three universities, are building big at this time. Mm-hmm. So that it's a very powerful situation that, you know, I find myself in walking among the students on University Place. So, you know, a neighbor's point of view, I feel harmed by the aggrandizement of NYU's presence in this area of the city. And as an urbanist, I feel injured by seeing the growth monopolies of universities taking up large segments of land in the city. Now, I have to say quite honestly that NYU's dormitories may have saved this area from becoming, at one point, an unpopulated or a depopulating slum. The dormitories that were built on 14th Street, the rental space for dormitories that was taken around Union Square 5 to 10 years ago, you know, that propped up those unrented buildings. So maybe I should say, it's not so bad that NYU comes into the breach at a certain point and rents space and builds space that otherwise would be empty. But I'm not going to say that. I could say that, but I'm not going to say that, because that goes along with this monopoly power that the university is creating in this area of the city. Now, I personally am not going to be harmed by turning Washington Square Village into a long-term construction site, but I can understand the hurt that's going to cause. I personally am not going to lose access to the green space that NYU is going to swallow up, because I was never allowed in there anyway. I mean, you know, is it really public? But the way the university builds is like the way real estate developers build buildings to camouflage public space, right? You know, there's no big welcome. There's not a welcome mat out in front of the public space. So again, I personally am not going to lose that space, because I never had that space when NYU built it as public space. And those playgrounds at Washington Square Village, those were not public playgrounds. Those were playgrounds for the people who live in those NYU buildings. So the loss of public space has already occurred. The building of the super blocks, the erasure of the grid, the engulfing of the neighborhood by NYU, that's already occurred. Now we have to take it back. So I rest my case.
Well, almost everything has been said. So I'm going to try to fill a few gaps. Perhaps one of the gaps that our missing speaker might have covered is what corporatization does to education and to the process of education. We are both associated with the City University of New York, which, at least formally, is still a public university. But one of our biggest problems is that the administrators who are appointed by the governor and the mayor come from the corporate world and bring with them an approach to education that really fits better in a city agency or in a private corporation, because education is understood as quantifiable goals to be achieved and then measured, and performance to be objectified in a way that administrators who no longer are educators. By and large, the administrators are hired for their capability to run a factory, a knowledge factory, that can produce fundable research, that can produce a value that can be exchanged on the market, that can sell books, that can sell knowledge, that can sell ideas and patent it. We face this every day in our public university because we are still organized in the old-fashioned way with the notion that the faculty is responsible for constructing a curriculum, for preparing syllabi, for organizing the pedagogical process and organizing work in the classroom. And we're confronted with administrators who either don't care or, worse, think they know how to organize the educational process. And in the interest of full disclosure, I am also a proud leader in the Professional Staff Congress, which is our faculty union. And this is one of the biggest obstacles we find, that our trustees, who are really CEOs, would love to be like NYU. NYU is the model. They would love to be able to raise as many funds as NYU has. They would love to be able to have the physical space. By the way, we don't have space either. You know, our classrooms are totally stuffed, and the physical plant is old, and so forth. But the aspiration is to become an Ivy League. Everybody wants to be an Ivy League school, and everybody wants to be and we talk in our faculty meetings about marketing ourselves and our school and our department and everything. It drives me crazy because I got into education because I thought it was a valuable pursuit, and that students come to learn not just how to get a job and make money, but we are retraining them to learn that that is the objective of education. So the humanities and those disciplines, history, these are non-productive disciplines. And we don't really need to spend so much money. I think, who was it that once said, Gore Vidal once said, United States of amnesia? Well, with good reason, because we don't teach history in our schools. It's devalued. Those areas of education that don't have an exchange value are devalued in our in our educational process. Another gap I'd like to fill is to talk about planning, which is the area that I teach and work in. And I look at the NYU plan, and I hear that it's being promoted as good design and a good plan. And we were talking before that one of the supporters is an admirer of Robert Moses. Well, would the designers had studied Robert Moses, they would have seen that Robert Moses had a great appreciation for open space, and that the continued reduction of open space in the NYU plan would have probably shocked him. His concept of the tower and the park was that you have a tower and you have a park. Now, all we have is towers. If you read the NYU environmental impact analysis, their claim is that the amount of open space is actually increasing. Well, come and I'll do the calculations with you, and I'll show you how you can make how those measurements how they made those measurements, and I'll show you how to do the measurements correctly. If you hire a landscape architect that knows how to create these beautiful pastels with lots of green trees all over, they can and then describe the existing condition in all black and white, gray and dark, you begin to convince people that this is an improvement. The other problem I see as a planner is that this the NYU scam is the latest in a long line of scams by large real estate developers and institutions to advance their plans through the city's land use review process. And the land use review process was set up in the 1970s so that neighborhoods and communities would have an opportunity to register their voice and participate in the decision making. Now, if you look at the development of New York City government for the last 40 years, 50 years, the power has been concentrated even more in the mayor's office, and it has more and more been, decisions have more and more served the interest of large developers, including large-scale institutions. And this is all in line with the growth machine idea, the idea of the luxury city. Mayor Bloomberg has really been the most eloquent in elucidating this. None of the previous mayors were really able to give it such clarity. He has said, we want growth in New York City, and we want more rich people to come to New York City because that's what makes a city great. And so so he argues with people who say, we have some problems with your proposals. And he says, well, you're just against progress and you don't want anybody to come that isn't like you. So it's the NIMBY charge, not in my backyard. Anybody who raises a question is automatically. So, I mean, the village crazies are in 59 community districts in New York City. We're all crazy because we don't share that vision of the city that is a city that's made by capital, for capital, by and for rich people. And there's really no discussion. So the Uniform Land Use Review Procedure, which began in the 1970s, it came out of many struggles. Jane Jacobs certainly was an important a fighter in that in those efforts in the 1960s and 70s to change the way decisions were made. And now it has become public relations opportunity for the developers. And this is how they do it. Whether it's a public or a private developer, whether it's a city agency or a real estate developer, they go around and they make their deals with people in the community, with businesses, with whoever they think might be a possible opposition. Used to be we had nonprofit corporations who might actually raise some questions and issues. Well, when we got a mayor who is the single largest contributor to nonprofit corporations, and his deputy mayor is also the chair of his foundation, we have a double whammy. We have private money and public money that is used to buy off potential opposition and real opposition in neighborhoods making deals. And all the deals get made before the formal land use review process. Now, you say, oh, maybe that's corrupt. Well, look, it's logical. If you're a developer and you want to get a project through, you're not going to start going through this 7-month process and then find all of a sudden that you get to the community board and they raise hell and they're against it. And then you get the borough presidents against it. And all of a sudden the city council starts getting nervous. And you spent 7 months, you did an enormous environmental impact statement, you had to pay $1 million for it, and you lost. So you make all your deals beforehand. You invite people in for whatever, drinks, or and you're honest and sincere, and if this administration is anything, they are honest and sincere, or at least they hire people who are honest and sincere, and who know how to acknowledge others. And so they make their deals, and then you get to the land use review process, and it becomes a show. People stand up and oppose, and it becomes a, it becomes a show without any substantive, with very little possibility that there's going to be a change along the way. Just for example, Mayor Bloomberg introduced 110 rezoning applications during his administration. Every one of them passed. Every one of them. Despite neighborhood and community board opposition, it didn't matter. The way the land use review process is structured, of course, if the community board votes against it, the other bodies, the borough president and the city council and the city planning commission, can vote for it and it'll pass. And so that creates a mentality from that at City Hall that community boards don't matter, that whatever they say, well, we'll make a few adjustments along the way, but most likely the deals that had to be made were already made in their eyes. So there's a fundamental problem with the democratic process, and it's a consequence of a very long process of imperial government, the failure to establish a sound institutional base for neighborhood governance, to provide resources to community boards, to provide them the technical resources as well as the financial resources that they will need in order to deal with complex issues such as university expansion. The final point I want to make about, it was touched on by other speakers. Universities have followed a very convenient paradigm for building their campuses. To some extent, it's admiration for the typical suburban, exurban campus with a lot of space, the Ivy League standard, where there are big quads all over the place and a lot of greenery. And so that is a possible model that universities are following, but I think the model they're following is the urban bunker, the urban enclave model, mm-hmm. which is our best game is to build everything in small, confined clusters. And if we could build a wall around them, that would even be better, but we can't do it in New York City. But we can put gates around them, as we can put 8-foot gates, if they'll let us, building the enclave. And in that sense, they're actually mimicking a global paradigm for urban development that I think NYU going to Abu Dhabi is perfectly appropriate, because they're building an enclave in the desert, essentially a walled city. And so we have to ask ourselves, what kind of cities do we want? Do we want our cities to be collections of isolated, separated enclaves? Or are we going to create open cities with free movement, freedom of thought, freedom of religion, freedom of speech, and freedom of movement? Post 9/11, New York City is moving very much in the opposite direction. As a city of enclaves, a city of secured enclaves, and all of NYU buildings, I assume, are secured by surveillance cameras and,
drones.
All of those, the access cards, right, and everything. I think planning, if we had a planning process, we don't really have a planning process. We have a zoning process. That we don't have a planning department that plans, we might be able to ask the real questions. Not whether NYU should expand, that's not the question. The question is, what kind of neighborhood and what kind of city do we want? What should it look like? And why should a single institution that's very large and powerful, or several large and powerful institutions, be able to put the plan on the table? So that we're forced to only discuss that instead of discussing what we want in our cities. What are our needs? And I guarantee that many more people would want to have an open city and would like to see more movement. That's not to say that there won't be those who want exclusionary enclaves, but at least we could have a dialogue. We could have a public discussion about what kind of city we want. And the way the Columbia plan was pushed through the land use review process, the same thing. There was a parallel process to produce a community plan that incorporated most of what Columbia wanted, and it was rejected. Or I should rather say, in the model of the new corporate marketing in which everyone's value is recognized, it was accepted formally and then thrown in the wastebasket. And that's the concept of participatory democracy that reigns, which is you can participate all you want, and we'll listen to you and we'll be polite, but we're ultimately going to make the decisions. And so I think this is where the process is broken, and this is yet another example of a broken process. But until people organize, and that's my last note, which is got to get out there and organize, because it's not going to change. And I don't believe that it's as gloomy as we've all made it out to be, because when people decide to get together and say no, it's not going to. That's not the way it's going to work. Gum up the works. Jane Jacobs was actually quite skillful at doing that. She was not just a critic, an intellectual critic. She was an activist. And she was involved with organizers who stopped Robert Moses in his tracks. And they spent hours and hours and days and days and years of organizing to do it. But if you don't do that, then we're only armchair critics. And we only have ourselves to blame for continuing the current situation. And I think it's grave. Everybody knows that we're watching a political circus in which money rules, and we're watching a city government in which money rules. And the most positive note has been Occupy Wall Street, because it has sent the message that people are not going to play that game. And so it's not good enough just to go to the City Planning Commission hearing, though everybody should go, but it's not good enough. We have to make it impossible for the City Planning Commission to operate as for business as usual with the City Planning Commission. That is a fundamental strategic objective. Thank you.
Okay. The floor is yours. Questions? Yeah.
Hi. I'm a former student of NYU, and
can you speak up a little?
Yeah. I'm a former student of NYU. I graduated a couple years ago, and I guess my question is for the professors who are against this plan. Has there been any talk about how to involve students? I'm just hearing you guys talking, and it seems like maybe one of the more compelling angles you could take is to say how is essentially operating on student debt.
Yeah, we've said that.
And like, is there any way to mobilize students that you guys are thinking about as part of bringing against?
Do you want to help us?
Yes.
No, seriously. No, that's a cop out. Yeah. You want to help us? You would be? Yeah, sure. I know a kiss off when I hear it. If you want to help us. You know, we're completely open to this. I mean, I know Andrew will want to address this, but we are extremely interested in involving students and have done everything we can so far to do that, you know, because it's crucial. If it weren't for student debt, this thing wouldn't even be feasible. That's one point. And then, you know, there's something more practical that's not going to necessarily interest only students on the left, and that is that this plan actually entails the destruction of the gym and its replacement by what they call a temporary gym. How many of you know this? Okay. The temporary gym that's supposed to replace the real gym is not a gym, right? Not a gym. It's not gonna have treadmills, weight room, squash courts, tennis courts, swimming pool, anything like that. It's only gonna be used for games played by the basketball and volleyball teams, so that NYU can keep its NCAA eligibility, okay? So they're still bringing kids and their families into Cole's gym on tours, okay? And leading them to infer that this is gonna be their gym, which is actually gonna be torn down next year, after they built the temporary gym, which is not a gym. So unless those kids are on those teams, they're either going to have to schlep up to 14th Street and go to the Palladium, where they can wait online for an hour to use a treadmill, or they can buy memberships to one of the several commercial gyms that have interestingly sprung up in the neighborhood over the last couple of years. See, now that's going to concern jocks and stuff, you know, and that's one way in which we have tried to engage students, but I hope you'll talk to me after the thing. And thank God somebody came through.
You have student debt yourself? Do you have student debt yourself?
Oh, yeah.
You do? Okay.
And no job, really.
Right. Okay.
I mean, well, there's a lot of energy out there that can be mobilized, for sure. Talking about it in that way, maybe using more like an occupying.
Though we have been. I'm one of the organizers of the Occupy Student Debt campaign, and we have actually been trying at NYU with students, with undergraduate students. We've discovered that undergraduate students in particular don't really perceive their debt as real. This is one of the big problems, ontological problems. It's not until you start paying off your debts, especially for students or people like yourself, you know, who are in this position, as are hundreds and thousands, millions of people right now who are student debtors. Their debt is real, but for undergraduates, they're very confused about how they fit into the political economy of a university like NYU. So graduate students have been particularly active, and especially in the organization NYU for OWS. But the administration doesn't pay any attention to graduate students or to faculty or to residents. It does care about undergraduate student voice, however, but that's probably our weakest, the weakest part of the alliance right now. And thank you for reminding us of that. But certainly alumni and most recently graduated students could play a big role in this. It's a big problem because there's very little student buy-in at NYU. That's why the endowment is so low at NYU, because alumni don't give a lot of money back to NYU. They haven't quite figured out the psychology of this. but your voice could be very important, and the voice of others like you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have a kind of follow-up to that, and it is what I think one of the reasons the undergraduates are not involved is they don't actually know what's at stake for them. And I'm wondering what kind of venues are available to communicate with undergraduate students across the campus. And there was that letter in the Washington Square News that just appeared of one of the students talking about the quaint Bohemians. And it seems to me that, you know, there ought to be some responses in the Washington Square News that inform the students of what, who's really going to be paying for that, and that, you know, that it's really going to be on their backs. It isn't going to do anything for them except maybe build a few more dorms that actually are too expensive for many of the students. A lot of them live in Brooklyn and other places because they can't afford the dorm. I mean, they need to know these things.
You're talking about the editorial that ran today?
Yeah,
we're talking to them.
Okay, but so what are the ways that we can reach the students across the campus?
Sharon?
In general, first of all, it's lovely to see many familiar faces, and even better to see some new ones. There are several venues that have been long-term organizers, and going to go first, obviously, if you are a member of the faculty, please, on Facebook, the NYUFASP on Facebook, for non-faculty on Facebook, CAAN2031, facebook.com/CAN2031, that's the Community Action Alliance on NYU2031. For both of those Facebooks, every time somebody posts, it will go out to all of your friends and help spread the word. We have to get past the critical mass. In addition, the community board has Facebook. All of us have websites. So all of us have email discussion groups. So depending on which interest group you are part of, there are umbrella groups like the Community Action Alliance, like the community board. There are four community board members here right now who are following this through, even though our resolution, which of course said absolutely no, has been David Gruber is the co-chair of the NYU Working Group on Community Board 2 and has to put up with me. So there are many ways to get out. As far as students, remember, we cannot get onto the property because it is, as Tom mentioned, access carded for safety. However, it only takes a few students in the different dorms to start working to evangelize this issue. We will produce documents, we will inform, invite us in events like this, bring more and more people in. We are organized, but we need to get more voices, more new voices, established voices, voices from the area east of Washington Square Park, voices from within Washington Square Village and Silva Towers on the super blocks, voices from the wilds of University Place. That is how we will stand. Like Jane Jacobs, she made a phone call and 200 people showed up at a meeting the next day. That is how we will do it, to sit and stay silent and hope that the rest of us will carry the ball. We'll do it. but with your help we'll win it.
Do you get contact information from anyone who is a student or knows students that are standing with, and let's go and explain it to them. So the student response that I have gotten is, it will happen after I'm gone. Mm-hmm. And that.
Oh, and can I speak to that? Because, you know, Tom was talking about basically discussing a kind of intellectual and, in the best sense, academic response to all this, having dialogue, trying to test hypotheses and the clash of arguments and all this stuff. That's completely antithetical to what comes down at us from this managerial colossus, which deals only in terms of managing responses and which deals very deftly with propaganda tactics. The reason why so many students and people in these complexes, by the way, have this thought that this isn't going to happen soon is because that was a deliberate propaganda strategy from the beginning. When I went to the first presentations that NYU administrators held for faculty in the fall of 2010, I look back on this now, I realize what the point was. They couldn't say often enough, this is not something that's going to happen soon. This is going to take a very, very long time to see through. And there's going to be room for people to weigh in. And we're going to, you know, modify things. But it's not as if the bulldozers are going to pull up tomorrow. I should have realized right then, the bulldozers are coming. You know what I mean? Now, last fall, all of a sudden, three things happened simultaneously at the complexes. Three things. Suddenly, they put a brand new jungle gym in the Key Park. Suddenly they landscaped the Sasaki Garden, which is crumbling. So it was like giving a shave and a haircut to, you know, a corpse. Right? And across the street, they suddenly put new tennis courts on top of the gym. See how smart this is? Because it gives you the feeling, without anybody having to tell you, yeah, this isn't going to happen soon. It's, you know, why would they be doing this if it was going to happen soon? So what we really are talking about here is a profound conflict that I don't really think can be resolved. I guess I'm echoing Tom here. I don't think it can be resolved.
I call it a con game.
A con game, right. I don't think, you know, they're not interested in talking to us. They're not interested in listening. That was abundantly clear at the community board hearings. The contempt, they don't even know how to pretend that they care. You know what I mean? That's how far gone they are.
May I just follow up one second? One of the biggest sea changes that happened was the formation of the faculty against the Sexton plan. We finally, I mean, I've been fighting this for 5 years now since the borough president's task force on NYU development, several of us, I see Toby and Bo and David, and the formation of faculty against the Sexton plan is the first time they blinked. And we're continuing to work together, but all of you, we need all of you.
Continue.
You know, I live right next to a construction, thank God it's over, but that's why I'm an activist. I was just a regular person. But when my bed shook, and people who go to the community board meeting know who I am, they shook my bed, they woke me up, now I'm a tiger, and I'm writing all kinds of letters. I'm so depressed, I'm going to kill myself tonight instead of waiting until next week. To think that everything I thought was true, you know, I was hoping there was like, wow, there was optimism, but no. Anyway,
hey, we're all optimistic. Yeah.
Can I share a bit of good news? It sounds like
thank
it might
you.
Be
oh,
a good yes. moment to share it. The politics department of NYU, of which I am a member, voted 29-2 against the plan.
One of the most conservative departments in arts and sciences.
Not only conservative, but a very apolitical department. It was very shocking. Now, mind you, the resolution was a little milder than some of us wanted. But it was quite clear, and everyone agreed afterwards, that it was a resolution against the plan. And now the word has already gone out to people in other departments that they have to have what's been called informational meetings, which allow for the department to get together, spend some time on the issues. Now, mind you, it's mostly the educational issues that they're concerned with, but it is a clear statement against the plan. Now, to what extent this is going to make a difference, we don't know, but this has gotten started at NYU.
Is this resolution for the public? I mean, is this, or for the record, can this be known,
yes,
what
yes,
they said?
Yes.
And this would be very good that you could read this. The more we know, the more we hear what the faculty says in specific words, what they say to each other, the better.
I personally am very ashamed that politics beat us to it. I mean, my department is usually... Huh? Oh, I'm sure every department, most departments at NYU, their faculty will be, if not unanimous, very close to unanimous. The issue really is, and I'll say this in a semi-public setting, because Occupy has been mentioned and bulldozers have been mentioned, and I really think the thing that will make a difference is if Occupy tactics are brought to bear upon the situation.
Absolutely.
Until people sit down and occupy and make it quite clear that people will be sitting in front of the bulldozers if they come. That will make the difference when it comes down to
it. I heard at one of these meetings that one of the people here, I don't remember his name, but he said, we will change ourselves to the cherry trees. You know, these kind of things. And in the first meeting, there was an elderly lady said, good works don't help. She was in her mid-80s. Late 80s said, we have to stand up. You know, I'm just referring to that. I'm just quoting some of this. I mean, there are some activists here. I'm from the student generation from 68 and from Colombia, but from Germany. There was a lot of noise there too. And I'll tell you something, I've been going to these meetings and I hold my fist up and I make a lot of noise because this seems to be one of the few things what you can do to really, in a democratic sense, speak up and make noise.
I think it's wonderful to hear that. And I just add, in reference to the earlier conversation, don't hold your breath for the students to come on board. It's not 1968. They won't be there. They're too busy doing three or four jobs to stave off going into further debt, among other things.
Let me just say that the importance of Occupy becomes particularly poignant when you realize that the city council is going to vote on this in like late August, when many of us won't be here, you know. And I can't agree strongly enough that the feeling among the residents, NYU and non-NYU, is running extremely high, and there will be people chaining themselves to trees. And it's, you know, I don't want to wax romantic about it, because with this police force and this mayor, that's not something you want to wish people to do, okay? But it could well come to that, and, you know.
My mother-in-law from Youngstown, Ohio, said she would visit us in prison. I mean, this is a generation already who is thinking ahead. I mean, this lady is 86, all right?
Okay. Chris, do you want to say something?
I mean, it is a miracle that the politics department did what it did. But it was not, happenstance. It was organized and very carefully organized, and it came from a variety of points. And if there was something unusual, it was the person who's the chair of the department got so motivated by the moral guilt he would have having just recruited four faculty into a construction zone. And so I think that is gone viral, and certainly in the Faculty of Arts and Science, all the chairs are wanting to get a copy of it, and maybe they'll amend it and make it stronger and, you know, do whatever with that. But it has to go everywhere else. But I wanted to put something on the table for discussion, because I think that while we have been asked periodically about mitigation, what could we buy you off with? You know, what would make you happy? Maybe passes to the gym. I can't say I can really give them to, but let's just say maybe between us. And this is the kind of conversation. This is the friendly folks who are coming out. So I'd like just to hear what you think with respect to this phase. I think it is a phase that we should count on 100% happening, with more and more departments saying, you're killing what we built. Or, as I like to say, you're shitting in our living room.
Can I answer you? because I've been intimately involved with this process, on precisely this point, mitigation.
Yes.
Obviously, the line of the day, the line of the week is, this is going to happen, okay? So you better be prepared to compromise. It's going to happen. And we met, a bunch of us met with Scott Stringer, and he did that. Well, I won't go into how he behaved, but you know, we were in there to tell him vote no, and he, you know, lectured us and said we were, you know, wild-eyed professors. We didn't know anything about reality and all this. We had been trying to explain to him that they can't afford the plan. You know, it's going to bust the budget. I think that's pretty realistic, right? But no, we don't know what's going on. He does. And he knows that the city council is going to vote for it, and so we want him in there negotiating on our behalf to forge a good compromise. Okay, that was kind of the point of the Michael Kimmelman article too. It's time for a compromise. Okay, now NYUFASP is sort of on the basis of his offer polled our membership, sent out a ballot. Do you want Scott Stringer to negotiate a compromise for you? So okay, take away the hotel. Okay, don't do anything to the Key Park, right? But of course, you leave all the other stuff standing, or make it bigger. And this is assuming that he can even negotiate anything, or would try, or they'd listen to him. But I put the ballot was much more objectively put, right? Or do you want just have him say no, and you want to stand with the community? And the exhilarating thing was, it was unanimous. It was unanimous, you know? Nobody wanted a compromise, right? Everybody wanted him to say no. Mm-hmm. Nobody trusted this process one bit. Nobody wanted to step away from the community. They just didn't want it to happen. And I have to say that the fact is really the fly in the ointment here. See, because we're the constituency that won't compromise, because the fact is, if they do this, a whole bunch of us are going to leave. You know, all these top faculty are going to go. And then they won't have any place to house their new people. So who's going to teach these 10 to 12,000 additional students they want to bring over in the next 20 years? Can't be graduate students. They're not going to apply here anymore. Right? Can be more adjuncts. Right? People are overworked, underpaid. There'll be bigger classes that people are paying more money to take. And you're letting in many more people, so you lower your admission standards, right? It sounds to us like if we compromise, we're going to basically acquiesce in the destruction of this university. So we're saying, no, we're not compromising. Let somebody else compromise. The compromise is, we were going to cut off all your limbs, but we're only going to cut off your legs. You know what I mean? So...
That's a good one.
Yeah, I just want to go back to the point to the lack of involvement of the undergrads, because I have the chance to be in the gym in the summer, where people with male usually have intimate conversations, and my conversation always is about this plan, and I bring this issue all the time, and the students say, well, I won't be there. Even the name of the brand, 2031, is sort of like so remote that I'll be dead by the time. Yeah. I'll be moved out of. Many faculty members say I'll be retired, living in another planet, and the students won't be around. But I was having a conversation here, and the students, one of the students say, I'll be graduated by that time. They say, oh, they're gonna start next year. Well, we have to do something. And I think we have to. It's very dangerous, that message that when you send in that everything is beautiful. Now we have flowers, we're changing things, we're changing the we're renovating the gym. They're renovating the gym. The stairways are closed because they're renovating. So there is a message, a false message, that this won't occur in the immediate future.
You still
and that's very dangerous.
Are you still going to the gym?
Yeah, I'm going.
So can you just talk to me afterwards, and we'll talk about your helping us spread the word among the gym goers?
Yeah, and there is another group. You know that group that they bring the Olympics disabled kids.
Oh yeah, but
sometimes they're like 100 kids, and they the person who organized that thing doesn't know about.
That's right. I just heard from her. We're going to talk to her. Okay, let me just give you the email address of the faculty coalition so you can contact us if you want to help us out. It's nyu.fasp, that's Faculty Against the Sexton Plan, at Gmail. Okay, nyu.fasp at Gmail. I should inform you that there's a second faculty group has emerged. I mean, we work very tightly with them, but they have a more anodyne name. You know, it's not as antagonistic and it doesn't mention Sexton. It's called NYU Faculty for NYU, and its entire focus is on the threat to academic integrity. You know, whereas our group is deals with all the problems, but you know, we're extremely close. The people who don't feel comfortable joining a group with a name like ours, or even to be associated with us, will join that. You know, and there's also a small group that's full of NYU parents together, because they're young families, you know, who use the Key Park and so on. So this is all great.
And if you're not faculty, info at CAS 2031.
Say it louder.
If you are not faculty, info at CAN2031.org. So everybody can join one way or another.
I want to thank all the panelists as well, and particularly Professor Miller for organizing this and for your very informative talk on the radio on NPR a few days ago. Yeah. Among the grab bag of strategies that we talked about, I circulated a petition earlier. If any of you haven't signed the petition, please do so. I have them here. Also, I suggest letter writing to Scott Stringer, the borough president, to Margaret Chin, our councilwoman for this area.
I want to thank my guests and thank you all for coming. And buy their books. Buy their books.
Send letters rather than emails. They pay more attention to letters with a stamp on it. And bury them, you know, with letters. Make calls to their offices. Talk to their receptionists, you know, to each of them. And this is one strategy among many.
Don't hurt them, though.
Mark.
Wait. Okay, Milt.
Just to follow up on Jesse, it's important, I think, one reason to write the letters is especially to ask him for a public hearing. So far, he's been, you know, it's 2 weeks away.
Scott Stringer.
Scott Stringer. He has to make his suggestion.
He's got to decide by April 11th. There's no way he's going to have it.
Yeah, so he's not, and that would be embarrassing for him, but... You never know. I mean, if he could, if press could come and hear the voices such as are being expressed here, he would hear the people as a form, you know, of people, movement and protest.
Can we go to his office and do it there?
That could be a strategy. I don't know. He's already has made up his mind. But.
If he's gonna split, you know, some for and some against, having a public hearing that is 95% against, that would be very difficult. So I could understand why he doesn't want a public hearing.
Did you have a question?
I'll take yours. I just want to point out that Scott Stringer is another strategy. He started to meet with separate groups of interested people. I was in one of the groups. I would also, if I just for a minute, I want to talk about a portion of the plan which has received less attention than it really deserves, and it goes right into the whole notion of the corporate university, which is the proposal to establish a commercial overlay on six straight square blocks between West 4th and West 8th Street. And here the university's claim that it needs more space is revealed for what it is, because this not only doesn't add to space, but it subtracts from space. By putting the university in commercial business, and as you said, what's happening in the university place in response to the student demand, Now the that at least is private industry. Now the university itself is responding to student student demand and such by setting up this commercial overlay. And I'm delighted to hear that we're against the whole plan, but I hope that this portion of the plan does not become a sacrificial lamb, because I think...
Oh, no, that can't happen. No, it absolutely can't. And this is just another amusing example of the kind of, you know, propaganda you get. Precisely because the commercialization of the area is upsetting people, Alicia Hurley of NYU, okay, she's just doing her job, okay? She responded with a statement that we sent out to our list, where she said, you know, it's just not, we're not interested in retail outlets in the first two floors of Washington Square Village. We're not interested in that. I mean, what we want is for it to be more transparent. Now, like, we're talking about doctors' offices and dentist stuff, maybe a coffee shop or a tea shop, but no retail outlets. No, just be more transparent. Can anybody tell me what that means? More transparent?
No.
Windows. Store windows.
Lots of windows.
Listen, I propose...
Nail salon.
I have to say this. I have to get this off my chest. I've been stewing over it since the community board hearings, like weeks ago, when they were taking... This was on January 18th. They were talking about the environment. And... they showed all these pictures of the all the greenery, and were basically saying this is so ugly, and you know it's terrible, and it's inaccessible. They kept saying that this is inaccessible. They showed what's now been turned into this little playground in front of the bank, right? They showed all this foliage and all these trees on LaGuardia around the statue of Fiorello, and they kept saying this is inaccessible. This is inaccessible. Okay, you know what? I think John Sexton's apartment is inaccessible. You know what I mean? I want to get access to his apartment, and I want to get access to his office. And I also want thousands of undergraduates to walk through there every day, you know, on their way to get a coffee at one of NYU's many coffee shops. That's what I think we should ask for, right?
They were once built that mailroom when there was a passageway through there.
That's right. Yeah, Sharon, you know, you must know that Washington, you know, the Sasaki Garden was far more accessible before NYU made it inaccessible. They put the strip mall in front of it. There used to be a stairway there. Then they started locking the gates. Now, they stopped doing that a few years ago, right? And there are a lot of people from the public who go in there all the time, and a lot of people who aren't at NYU who use the playground. So it really has become a kind of public space. But, you know, it's the typical thing where you create, you starve an area, and it becomes dilapidated because of your efforts. And then you say, this is blighted. We have to get rid of this blighted area and build a stadium or something.
Called urban renewal.
Yeah, urban renewal. Back to the beginning. I want to thank my guests, and thank you all for coming. And buy their books.